For the protection of my media. A poet is not. a danger is you, but for filling, you need capital, you need money. And money, as you all know, always comes with strings. So the capital, the financial capital, how it plays out, is also reflected in the movie making. So I mean, it all started, I mean, if you look back initially, it all started with the big studio houses, both in Hollywood, again coming to India, in India also. And they even tightly controlled who you can put in the films, the actors, who should go into the actors. I'll request you to recall the 1950s McCarthy era. When McCarthy was the Secretary of War in America, he had a list of prohibited writers that, I'm sorry, prohibited actors that included even Charlie Chaplin. So the film director did not even have a choice for who to cast, who not to cast. Apart from how the money came, how the production houses decided the films, the scheme of the film. So it's a tightly controlled media, and it's also a media that requires a lot of compromise. I mean, as a writer, you can say, I won't do this, I can't remain silent, but film means, in this money, you also have, it's an art of many people, so it continuously involves compromises. So ultimately, does this mean it's not an art? Yes. How film achieves its ultimate artistic objective is through subversion. It subverts the society made by the world. I mean, you show two images, unconnected two images, and the third meaning that emerges is the subversion. You can see how it happens all over. Even the latest movies, it throws in a catalytic process that is against the run of the society. So, if you go back again to the state control, the most state control film industry, the first state control film industry was the Soviet film industry. Soviet film industry, during Lenin's time, had produced some of the most greatest wonderful films that were subversive, that completely distorted and newly presented the presentation of images, the concept of montage, of editing, of presenting a sequential or non-linear set of images came through in Lenin's time. That was a really surprising, because Lenin was a very conservative atheist, but the three of them, Lenin, Trotsky, and there was a third person, Lunacharsky. These three of them put forward a doctrine of film that gave independence to the film makers. So early age Soviet films was actually one of the pioneers of filmmaking in the world, in spite of it being entirely state financed. And not only state financed, also helped by state. And you can think of huge sets. The entire Odessa harbor can be your set. So this is how the state, and with a set of very imaginative film actors, put forward and school of expressionism and to an extent surrealism in filmmaking in the early Soviet period. In the later Soviet period, which I come, there is Stalin's era, in which the image reproduction was reduced to cliché making. Stalin called it socialist realism, but it was actually soulless. And the mere propaganda machinery for the Soviet Union. So if you have gone to the British, the Museum of Films, then they show well, how during Stalin's period the film was used to propagate communism. Every railway coach used to have a film screen, and they used to show a small film, and some Soviet cadet, some young guy would come and explain the uses of communism or collective agriculture, things like that. So films sold immediately after the Leninist era was eradicated in Soviet Union. One of the greatest movies of that period was, as you all know, is Battleship Potemkin. Battleship Potemkin was produced by Sergei Eisenstein. Eisenstein himself had produced a movie called Strike. Later, Eisenstein went on the producing films, but he had to stop it halfway around. He was tortured, he was made to self-confess that is, all his movies are bad. He ran away to America, he went to Mexico and wanted to do a film with the famous American writer Upton Sinclair. He went to USA, he wanted to start a film, but either with the tight and almost soulless Stalinist era or in the Japanese era, Sergei Eisenstein didn't survive. But in Battleship Potemkin, we had introduced the concept of editing or montage as a movie. Two people who watched this movie very carefully were totally captivated by Potemkin. They understood the subversive power of films, how films can be used as a propaganda machine, and how it can really reach the masses. These two people were none other than Hitler and his publicity team, Goebbels. So Hitler's inspiration to turn, I'm coming to Lenin, Hitler's inspiration to turn to films came actually from the Soviet era, Eisenstein, Philip, Potemkin. So Hitler came at a time when there were real problems. The problems, and very real and recognizable process. Germany was defeated in the war, economically there was depression, huge unemployment, unprecedented inflation, decadence of society, moral and personal corruption, irreconcilable class warfare between the rich and the poor, between the worker and the factory owner, national stagnation, shame, and an aborted revolution. So, this was the Germany to which Hitler came. And if you read Mein Kampf, Hitler's autobiography, My Struggles, you can see this man saw himself as a superman, as a manly figure, and he saw the German masses as a woman. And the way to make love to this woman is through propaganda. So seducing the masses through propaganda was Hitler's aim, and for that he chose Philip. It's like this. He is a monomaniac, cannot seduce a single woman. So what did he choose to do instead? He seduced the whole nation. In Mein Kampf, I mean, this is a quotation from Mein Kampf about Nazis. Their receptivity is limited, and they are fools. He's saying that. The masses' receptivity is limited. Their intelligence is small, but their power to forget is enormous. So we had all the elements to launch upon a supreme, a nation which is lighting up, and here he is standing up masculine. Again, guys, in their overwhelming majority, they are so friendly, they are like women. The masses need a commander, they don't need a petitioner. It is in this society, if they are wanting to impose upon you as a man, a big man, a man on the stage. Yes, repetition of history, we have seen it. We have seen it every day. You go to North Korea, Kim Il-sung's grandson is doing it. Somewhere in our neighborhood also, this side. How a macho leader is trying to seduce the masses. Then Hitler's attention falls to cinema. So, this is what it says about cinema. More than man needs to use his brains, even less he will accept pictorial representation than a newspaper article. Seeing pictures is easy on the brain of the masses. Reading is difficult. So go for the films. The Hitler had very poor opinion about women. His famous statement is that a German girl is a subject. She becomes a citizen only after marriage. So with this ideology of propaganda, and understand your feeling, which was not far from untruth. Hitler launched upon one of the greatest engagement of fascist thought in films. The most famous, the greatest propaganda film ever made was by Hitler or the fascist Germany. It is, as you all know, The Triumph of Will. A man who had such contempt for women chose a woman, Leni Riefenstahl, to make that movie. She was already famous, she was an actress, she was beautiful. And she had already made a movie called The Blue Light. She was actually a lover of films. And in 1934, 1 year into power, after Hitler came into power, Hitler looked around at the world and he could see that nobody knew about him in the world stage. Nobody knew about how great Hitler in Germany also. So you need to go to Madison Square, you need to go to San Jose. But he thought he must bring the world to Germany. So for that, in 1934, he had a big rally in Nuremberg. It's called the Nuremberg Rally. About 1,000,000 people participated in it. And Lenin was asked to make a movie about it. Lenin did not make a movie on Nuremberg Rally. What Lenin made is a recreation of Nuremberg Rally. It was play-acted, it was put on a set, it was acted out again with Hitler himself participating. This was the only fascist film in which Hitler acted. So some mind-boggling figures are there. 130 technicians were put on place. 90 cameramen. The cameramen were on roller skates, lit on huge platforms built all over Nuremberg. Bridges. And 1 million extras, 1 million people acted in this movie. Later, much later, in his Lenin told a lie to the press in 1948 after the war that what he showed was actually true. But historically, it has been proved was, this was a stage show, the actual Nuremberg rally was a much smaller affair. The star of the movie was Hitler. He arrives from the cloud in an aeroplane which will now look ridiculously small, but he came down from the cloud and he addressed, he comes down, and there's a brilliant shot that this movie is. It is one of the most brilliant movies I have seen. There is a hugely brilliant shot in which about 1 million people park the way. It is like the, say like the movie Ten Commandments, some ocean park the way, and Hitler, Himmler and Goebbels, three of them walk from one end to another, the whole panoramic shot, walks to the War Memorial of First World War Germans, lays wreath and walks back. It's a whole 10 minutes sequence of exquisite cinematic beauty, but utterly soulless. So it was the triumph of which was ultimately the phony submersion. It presented a huge Superman to the world. The world believed it because they were told that this was how the Nuremberg rally was held, and this is how Führer, the Hitler, is being worshipped by the people of that country. Profoundly subversive, profoundly dangerous masterpiece of visual experience. This, the Hitler actually tried it out. This is not the first time they are doing it. In 1933, that is, in 1936 was Lenin's movie, Triumph of Will. In 1933, a movie was made, Funeral of Hans Hessel. Hans Hessel was a small-time Nazi who died, and his funeral was held in a small-time fashion, with very few people attending. But after seeing this movie, Hitler thought this is not how a small-time Nazi should die. So he completely recreated. This vessel was supposed to have been killed by the communists. He completely recreated the funeral by thousands of people attending, huge cortege, and hundreds of people following, and thousands of communists rioting on the road, and they were being beaten up by the Nazis. So he had tried, and he knows how to recreate history. So this movie was produced by one of the Nazi news film makers, but he got probably one of the best filmmakers of that time, Lenin, for making this movie. So the next movie, which is almost a masterpiece by Lenin, was 1936, Berlin Olympics. Again, 60 photographers, 480 miles, that is 25.5 lakh feet filling. Three kinds of filling were used. Alpha for shooting buildings, Kodak for shooting descriptive scenes, and Terutz for shooting lawn and the grounds of Olympics. Again, the German superiority, how Germany takes to wins. If you recall the 1936, the Berlin Olympics, the real hero was Jesse Owens, the American black Jesse Owens, even longer than that. The Germany, Hitler and Nazis all around. So this is probably the pinnacle of fascist engagement of films. There were others, two other significant movies which I want to mention. One was by Hans Bertschaft, which was produced in 1939, which is called Baptism of Fire. It's a terrorizing movie. It is how Germany attacked Poland. The blitzkrieg of Germany over Poland. The movie's intention was to terrorize the world about the Nazi power. The second movie was much more worse. It's by, well, I'm a good filmmaker, Fritz Kipler. It's called The Eternal Jew. It shows how bad the Jews are. It really makes the audience convinced that the Jews need to be put to the final solution. How? So these are the two other significant movies of the Hitler's era. Now I'll digress a bit and tell you what happened to Leni after that. Leni, immediately after the war, was put to the Nuremberg trials. She was found innocent because she had no doubt. She was a filmmaker. She loved to make her films, and anybody who gave her an opportunity to make films, she was allowed to make it. Then she made a film called The Flight. It was actually her confession of a retribution, a method of seeking retribution to what she had done during the Nazi era. But the people, rightly so, did not allow her to exhibit this film. Then Leni withdraws to Africa, stays with the African tribes. She stopped making movies and she started clicking photographs. She became a black and white photographer. So in 1997, she was 95 years old. In Paris, she was holding an exhibition of her African tribal photographs. The exhibition was about to be opened, and the people did not allow her to show it. Because she had established ideologically, visually, an unpardonable regime in the minds of people. I was very coincidentally, I was there in Paris when this was happening. So I could see her, a very old, haggard woman, trying to please some people. But I'm a post-war born people, but the veterans, the people who have suffered during the war, were not allowed to open that gallery. That was a big lesson to the world that there is nothing but pure art. All art is political, and if your politics goes on, you will have to pay heavy fine. Till 2003, she died in 2003, 102 years old, she was not forgiven. She was not forgiven. The Nazi supporters, like there are great musicians, even P.G. Woodhouse had broadcasted for Nazis. There are writers, they were all forgiven, but Leni was never forgiven by the Europeans or by the world, because such is the power of feelings, and she established the Nazi paradigm in the minds of the world. Film movements in Italy during Mussolini's time. But Mussolini took a completely different method altogether. So how different the German and Italian in our cliches comes through to the Italian way of fascist cinema. What he did was, he tried to promote soft romances. And he was trying to sell the escapist fiction through the fascist cinema. And only real hardcore fascist films he made were about the wars. The wars in which Italian fascist soldiers used to be victorious. Also newsreels. Then there was Stalin, who had completely denigrated the great Soviet filmmaking machine into some kind of a model. And that was probably after the World War, in this time, in our period, how will the, what is the position of film? Many things have changed. There's an enormous growth of financial capital. There's an explosion of media. How important is film now? Film is competing with radio, film is competing with television, film is competing with the most powerful media of our times, internet, web. So how important is the film? And if you think of India too, 2015, how important is film? There are two ways of looking at it. It is not at all important. Otherwise, how can you put a man like Gajendra Chauhan as top of India? If you think it is important, film schools are important. You know, Polish film school changed the European film. The Havana school changed the Cuban film. Film schools are important. If you think the reproducibility of the film idea is important, would you put a person like Gajendra Chauhan? Probably, do you think the rulers don't know the importance of film? I think they know it because they are controlling, tightly controlling the exhibition. The CPSC under Nihalani and other members of the CPSC is tightly controlling the film exhibition. The film schools are not important in the scheme of things because there are alternate methods. Not all filmmakers of this era or any era have come from the film schools. There are alternate methods. They generally graduate from digital filmmaking. So probably our players are right in not considering FTIL as important enough, not to give it a hardcore or an ideological separation other than an ex B grade actor. So there could be, this is something I have a feeling that the rulers probably know what they are doing. And there is a multiplicity of media. Where are the people are getting influence? And the corporatization. Where are the corporations now investing? They are definitely investing in film because the subversive nature of film still remains. There is no other art in which you take 2 hours of your life, go into a dark room and sit yourself and allow yourself to be bombarded with images. There is no other art. So film is subversive, but there are, for opinion making, there are a multiplicity of other means, mainly probably in this era, the most important thing is the news channels. The news channels have been purchased by the big corporates who are always, well, all corporates at all times are mostly pro-government. So from there to the exhibition of films, the is how and where we have come. But what is happening is there is the individuals taking over the role of the state when it comes to fascist engagement with the film. In a media that can't be centrally controlled like Facebook or internet, what they are doing is putting hundreds and thousands of volunteers to propagate their messages. Similarly, in a non-uniform manner, non-unified manner, the fascist message is getting reproduced in our time, in all countries, and more so in India. So the similar kind of fascism That is, an India, an ideal India, the nation, the Hindu nation, which doesn't need proof, which speaks a single language, which is racially superior. This India is getting projected in multifacetedly through different individuals and corporate house. So finance feelings. But in the end, probably feeling will survive, will prevail, because the basic film art is subversion, and I think films will continue to have the power to subvert all the evil forces that may come in this way. Thank you very much for giving this opportunity to speak about a great anarchist who was just the opposite, the anathema of centralized controlled filmmaking on this occasion. Thank you.